Okay. celebrate the choir. Let's celebrate the Lord. Let's celebrate the choir. Give glory to God. Give glory to God. Give glory to God. Give glory to God. Amen. I want to give thanks to God for the youth choir, Foresight Choir. The Lord God Almighty renew your strength and bless you and increase you and your ministry in Jesus' name. Amen. Please help me shake your neighbor by your left and right. Tell them I'm glad you are in church this morning. I want you to say it like you mean it. Say it like you mean it. I'm glad you are in church this morning. I'd like you to tell the person, I know God will do something in your life this week. I know. Not that, I'm not saying I think God will do something in your life. I know God will do something in your life this week. Amen. From today right through to the end of this family week, God has prepared special deposits to be made in our individual lives to better our lives and lift us up in different ways. Your family will never be the same again. Every one of us here is a representative of the family you come from. All right? I want to say here, as the Lord empowers you, as the Lord prepares you, as the Lord blesses you, as the Lord drops something in your life, you are taking it as an ambassador of the family, taking it back to the family, and cause a positive change for the glory of God. Amen. All right, I'm glad you are in church this morning. Amen. I'd like to appreciate all of you for praying for me and with me as we traveled to Warri last week to do ministrations in First Baptist Church in Warri from Sunday through to Wednesday. We came back on Thursday. We want to give thanks to God for what God did in the course of those 4 days of spiritual impact in the lives of our brethren out there. And thank you for being at home and praying along with us. Your prayers were heard. We saw the hand of God, and God blessed the people. I want to thank you so much for praying. I'd like to appreciate Pastor Ajibade and Pastor Dari for standing in the house, along with members of the diaconate, for keeping the work going in our absence, which has released us and allowed us to go do this business beyond the spheres of this local assembly. I want to thank you so very much. We like to appreciate all of you also for being there. If you don't come, they can't lead anybody. You can't come here and lead the pews. I want to thank you so much. May the Lord continue to bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Glad to be back again to the house. I will pray that the grace of God will continue to rest amongst us. Let me especially appreciate Brother Agolia and his wife and all the coordinators, zonal coordinators of our family ministry. I want to thank you so much for helping and working. You've been working around the clock to ensure that this week is a success. The fact that we have started this service today is a clear sign that the week is going to be a great success. We pray that the Lord God Almighty will bless everyone during this week in Jesus' name. Amen. The rain was threatening this morning to do the same thing it did last week. I looked up to the heaven. I said, God, no, not again. Not again. Last Sunday, we had almost like 3/4 or half of the assembly come to church. We said, no, not again, not again. And thank God that the rain cooperated, it obeyed, all right, and has allowed us to be in church. You're welcome. Some of you have not seen you since the last 2 Sundays, because last Sunday you were at home, you were in house arrest. The rain kept you at home. Thank you for coming today. God bless you. Amen.
And there's a man part. God cannot come and help you love your wife. It is you that must love the wife. God cannot come and help you be submissive, man. It is you that must be submissive. See, God has done his own part to give us the manual. We must be the one that would read the manual, work the manual, and make the manual work for us. Because except we work by the manufacturer's manual, we cannot have good success in our marriage. We cannot be prosperous in our marriage and even in life generally. So it's critical that we all understand that to have successful home, number one, we must stick to the manufacturer's manual. We must go back to the basics. We must go back to the root. And the root is the word of God. The root of every good marriage is the word of God. The foundation of any good marriage is the word of God. The reason there are divorces everywhere now, and unfortunately even in the church now, is because we have left the word of God and we have taken on our own ways and the ways that the world has suggested to us to run marriages. And so after a while, people get despondent. Listen to me. It is important, and for those of us who are young and who are still aspiring or who are just young in our marriage relationships, tough times will come. Tests will come. In fact, your love for each other will be tested. Your love for your spouse will be tested. There will be temptation to commit adultery. Temptation is not sin. Temptation is presentation between right and wrong. Now you make the choice. It is when you give in to the wrong that you fall into sin. Temptation provides for you the opportunity to make the choice between good and evil. But the choice we now make is whether we walk out of that temptation or we walk into the temptation. So you must understand that in life, listen, you get married, you love this lady so much. Ah, she's the apple of your eye. She's the only sugar in your tea. That man is the one that makes you smile. He is the MacLean with which you brush your toothpaste, your tooth, and you can smile well. When he shows up in the room, you are all smiling. And then we get married. What happened? Then he starts getting you upset. Then you start fighting. What happened? Life happened. When we get to know each other better, when we get to know those little sides of that person, when she's singing in the choir and she's singing, "Pray," and you're like, "Wow, you were great, yes, you are, mighty God." You're like, "Jesus, that's my woman. Hey, that's her. Oh, my bat, yeah. Man, I doff my heart." But one thing, listen to me. If we read the word of God and we see the reality of who a person is, we won't be repelled. Because the Bible says, love is not resentful. But you see, that person is a real human being. If you married a real human being, I must allow them to be real. You didn't know that sister has artificial tribal mark after she sleeps and wakes up. You will get it when you go home. You didn't understand that brother, he releases some Yusuf after eating a dick icon and pounded yam. Then you're like, "What happened?" I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about the sister sitting next to you. And then you're like, "What's going on with him?" Over 24 years in ministry, I've counseled with people, I've cried with people, I've seen people who fight. Sometimes we have disagreements and then we turn around and say, "What exactly were we fighting about?" Because the person didn't close the cream very well. Or they used the toothpaste and they left it open. I know you've never fought about that. You've never fought over that. I'm talking about myself. So that you won't start looking at your neighbor. Praise God. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 1, the Bible says, "Therefore, I, a prisoner, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling." Your calling, your first calling, ladies and gentlemen, is your family. Before you lead anybody, madam, before you are the CEO or MD of that bank, your first calling is your home. My first calling is my home. And even as women, we must understand how to remove the crown of MD when we get home, put it by the door. Enter the house, be the submissive wife and the loving mother, and when you are going back home tomorrow, carry the crown, put it back, enter into the car and let your driver take you to work and go and exhibit your duties. Praise the Lord. We need the balance. See, our calling, first of all, is our family. Any nation is born out of family. Everything, all of us are a representation of one family. And what we are outside is a representation of the homes that we come from. Every person in every nation comes from a family. Every person in every church comes from a family. Our first calling, ladies, to walk worthy of our calling, we need some principles of God's word. For we have been called by God to live exemplary life in our families and through our family life. You cannot lead effectively, sir. Lead a corporation effectively if you cannot lead a woman. Or lead your children. It is very critical because the Bible even says that the bishop should be the husband of one wife who rules his house. Well, now when I'm saying rule, I'm not saying the headmaster who has a sledgehammer. You know, in those days, when our daddies used to come home, I don't know, I'm sure there are no daddies like that in this house. I'm very sure. There can't be. Not in this house. But when those daddies were coming in those days, when you hear zoom and daddy's packing, everybody would disappear. Then you start reappearing one by one. No, I'm not talking about you. Maybe I'm talking about me. Then everybody would start reappearing one by one. Welcome, sir. Welcome, sir. Welcome, sir. Now, that's good. Respect in the home is good, but when you are a terrorist, and even when you are coming home and the wife is almost peeing, and the children just take off, that's not a representation of Christ. Because Christ does not, if Christ shows up as a terrorist, we won't be here. All of us will not be attracted to come and be in his presence. Fathers, we must be fathers. That's your first calling. Where your family, they're so excited to have you back. They're eager to have you back. They're excited. Mothers, that's the way we should be. I know this life is stressful, but honey, that's our first calling. And our first calling is to our family. Number two, humility, gentleness, and patience, and forbearance. We see that in verse 2 of Ephesians chapter 4. It says, always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Be humble and gentle. Look up here a minute, saints of God. Humility and gentility, and gentleness are critical ingredients in the cooking of a happy home. In the cooking of a home that is called to love. Yes, you may be the madam of the house, but the madam needs to be gentle and humble. Humility. Humility is that thing that makes you calm down, put yourself under, allow others. It means you are simple, but you are not stupid. Humility is key. Humility is required of all of us, both male and female, in the home. A man needs to be humble in his home. How do I mean? Not that you will not be the head. You are the head, but serving with humility. Which means you don't just call people anyhow and treat them anyhow because you are the man of the house. Gentility. Being gentle. Being humane. Treating your children with kindness and care. Treating your wife with kindness and care. Boss, hey, come here. That's your wife. Nkechi. Honey, is that a dog or? Honey, and then you say, oh, I love the man. He's the head of the family, and you dress him and everything. And then, kunle alori oda. But that doesn't sound to me like gentle or humble. It says be patient with one another. We need that patience, ladies and gentlemen. Your wife will not be everything you require for her to be in a day. Rome was not built in a day. Your husband will not become everything you require for him to be in a day. It is God that works in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Woman of God, whilst you are praying for him to be all that great man that you require for him to be, honey, pray. Whilst you are praying, be patient. And man of God, whilst you are praying for her and hoping for her to be everything that you want her to be patient with her. I'm not everything you are seeing today overnight. My husband took time to work on me. Every man is required to cultivate his wife. Cultivate his wife. Which means you must marry somebody that you are able to submit to, who can cultivate you. We require gentility. Speaking kindly to a woman. Listen to me, men. It amazes me, and I say this with all due respect. I love men and I respect them. But I came to realize that a lot of men boast, I know women. You know what? I realize they have no clue. Let me tell you a secret. A woman can kill herself and cut her head and put it on the ground for you if only you are kind to her. If only you are kind. Every woman loves soft treatment. That's why the Bible says, treat her as a weaker vessel. Tenderly, kindly. Yes, she's your wife, but I think leadership is more respected when that leader is humane, when he's considerate, when he feels what you feel. If you want your wife to love you and you want her to be submissive, be kind. Be nice. Speak kind words. I usually, this one, all the women can close their ears for this 1 minute. But men, even if you are not romantic, there's an expo in the Bible I can share with you. Go and read Songs of Solomon, from chapter 7 to chapter 9. You get all the original you need. You get everything you need to make her, you know, she'll be spinning. You left for work 6 a.m. together, came back perhaps 7, 8, 9, or 10 in Lagos together, and then you come back home and you carry newspaper and sit down in front of football. What's the latest? What happened? Oh, Chelsea and Leicester are playing today. Mourinho! Hey! No, he has left Mourinho. It's Manchester United. Manchester United are playing. So you say, Man U, let me see all the reviews. What happened between Chelsea and Leicester? They're beating them 3 times. Okay, yes, the next one. And then you are waiting for her to go and cook and bring it to the table. Don't forget, when you left in the morning, you left angrily and spoke to her angrily. And then you are coming back home now and you are not helping out. And then when it is like 11 o'clock, you say, come on, babe, how's it going? And he's wondering. She's thinking, seriously? Which babe? I'm tired. When she says she's tired, it's a nice way of saying about going. Buy her something nice. See, even if you don't have money to buy a woman anything, if you are kind to her and you listen, men are confused. You know, what can make a man go off totally and lose his cool? In fact, he's shaking inside even though he looks comforted outside. When a woman comes to her husband and says, honey, we need to talk. If you don't want to scare your husband, don't say that. Because he's wondering, don't tell me we need to talk. Just talk. Just say it. Because the man is apprehensive. What do we have to talk about? What is the problem? Have I done anything wrong again? You know, because we women, we can catalog it in our minds. And then begin. You give a woman one offense, she's pregnant with that offense. After 3 weeks, she gives birth to 3 bouncing baby boys and delivers them to you. What am I saying? Gentleness, kindness is very critical. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 4 verse 2, be kind. Women, we must be kind and gentle with the men in our lives. Our men will make their mistakes. But it takes a patient woman, a woman who is gentle, a woman who is kind, to win her husband back. And a lot of it goes on our knees. But that character of gentility and patience with each other is very key in the house. Number 3, understand that each one of us has a different gift. And we see that in verse 7. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Grace according to the measure of gift. Hear me and hear me well. All of us, by our temperament and by our making, have different gifts. I'm gifted in certain ways that my husband is not gifted. Some of us have temperament where we're very extrovertic. They're called the sanguine. Very extrovertic. Life of the party. Merry go happy. Some of us are melancholies. And you must understand the different temperaments of your spouse. Or what temperament your spouse is. That way it will help you to relate well with them. Some of us are melancholy. We are very analytical, very detailed, very calculative. These ones are the ones that make the best doctors, the best lawyers, you know, all those. Very intentional. We're very meticulous. We measure everything. We don't jump at anything. Very analytical and can be very sober sometimes. Think deeply, you know, calculative. That's the melancholy. Then there is a choleric leader. They call the shots. They are restless when things don't go right. He's the one that shows up and tells everybody, sit down. Oh, there's a problem. Oh, yeah. Okay, let's do it that way. That's the way, you know, he commands everybody and tells everybody, you know, okay, do it. You come. Say, sit down there. Stand up. Okay, here's what we're going to do. You have a problem. Okay. No problem. I'll resolve it. Give me 1 minute. Okay, you know what? Here's what we're going to do. Move the money from this account to this account. Pick that. That's the choleric. He knows exactly what he needs to do. She knows exactly what. She's strong-willed. She knows exactly what she wants to do. She's driven. She's an achiever. She's a go-getter. They never get tired. They are never lazy. They are never tired. Those are the cholerics. Then you have the phlegmatic. Gentle. Easygoing. No stress. They can be very laid back. Maybe you are married to somebody who you have to wind them before they take a step. And they are not in a hurry. They are never in a hurry. They walk very gently. They are at peace with it. They just like peace. They don't want trouble. People like that exist. So right now, I'm sure I'm analyzing your spouse or somebody you know. I have a set of twins. Two of them are so different. One of them is very sanguine and melancholy. The other person is very phlegmatic. I mean, in fact, she can walk into the house. You won't even know she has arrived. She's very quiet, very reminiscent. She's very focused, detailed, everything, very quiet. In fact, she speaks to me, only the two of us in the room. I can't hear what she's saying. I'll say to her, honey, I heard nothing. I didn't hear a word of what you said. Mommy, did you hear what I said? That's the way my daughter speaks. So there are several species, and God thinks all of these species are beautiful. Hear me. Nobody is an error. None of us is a freak of nature. None of us was a mistake. None of us was an accident. God deliberately chose the fabric of our lives delicately and wove it together to create this beautiful piece of art that you see as your spouse. So for you to be criticizing the personality of your spouse is literally like blaming God. Who made them? Why did you make this person like this? How dare I do that? You cannot love a person and criticize their personality. And let me warn us, please never compare your spouse with another person. They will never be that person. They are not that person. If you had wanted, you should have married that other person. But it's an error to come and compare. Can't you see Sister Lizzie the way she... Hello? I'm not Sister Lizzie. This is me. Your spouse is beautiful in their personality. Matter of fact, listen to me. If all of us were extroverts, the world would be too noisy. If all of us were sanguine, extroverts are sanguine, the world would be too noisy. If everybody was a phlegmatic, too quiet, too calm, the world would be too boring, you'd be too calm, too... And if all of us were too analytical, too, you know, serious-minded, the world would be too serious. And if all of us were leaders, who we follow? So you are perfect for your purpose. If you are light, love yourself as light. If you are dark, love yourself as dark. If you are tall, love your spouse as tall. If the spouse is tall, love them as tall. You chose them, sir. You chose them, ma. Or you chose her, or you chose him, ma. If any woman is taller than your wife, she's too tall. If any woman is slimmer than your wife, she's too slim. If any man is fatter than your husband, they are too fat. Your husband or your wife is perfect for their purpose, and that's why God chose them for you. And so it's very important that all of us take notes and we're mindful of these things. Understand that we have gifts. All of us have gifts. Sometimes some of us are creative, and that's why we have beautiful homes. Whatever gift your spouse has, please allow them to manifest that gift to benefit your life. There's a benefit in your husband by their temperament. There's a benefit for you in your wife by her temperament. If we allow each other to blossom, if you allow my temperament to blossom, you will get the best of me. If I allow my husband's temperament to blossom, I'll get the best of him. God put a gift in everyone for each other. None of us is an island by ourselves. We can't survive by ourselves. From the cradle to the grave, we will all need people. We need each other. Help me turn to your sister or your brother next to say, I need you. Turn to the next and say, I need you. Husbands and wives, we need each other. Don't criticize the person's gift. What? You are too scattered, though. You are too scattered. I don't like this scatter. What? Hey! But listen, they may be too scattered, but very responsible. Why don't we eulogize and face that responsible part and appreciate it? My husband doesn't like cooking. He doesn't like cooking. In fact, when he was young, his mom, ordinary beans, his mom would say, please watch it. Watch it for me. Oh. When it's time, when you notice it's soft, call me. Let me do all the other additions. He would say yes. The beans will get burnt. He never likes cooking. After we got married, one day he tried to make custard for me. The custard had cocoa as big as this. I took it in love. For it was costly. Yes. I took it in love. Because he said, is he nice? I said, yes. Nice. Because I saw the effort. I was pregnant and I couldn't go to cook, but I saw the effort with which he went to do it. I had to eat it in love. Say, is he okay? Say, ah, yes, it's okay. Said, I poured the powder, and when the water boiled, I just poured it and say, yes. Now, hear me. He wasn't the best of all cooks. He couldn't cook his custard right. But how about the thoughtfulness? Because if he didn't do it, I can't arrest him. How about the person's thoughtfulness? Why do we focus on 20% of a person's mistake or what they cannot do and ignore the 80% that they have? He may not be able to cook well, but honey, there is no time I'm going to give birth that my husband is not there. He stays with me. Not all men do that. I applaud that. He's a responsible father. He provides for me. He provides for the children. He's there. He's responsible. I celebrate that. Oh! Cecilia is not as organized, though, as her sister. She's always scattered. Cecilia may be scattered, but she's a faithful wife. She's hardworking. How about celebrating that? All of us have gifts. You may be organized. Help me in the way I'm not organized. Don't criticize me or kill me because I'm not organized. The reason you are in my life is to help the weaknesses in my life. If the two of us are exactly the same, one of us is unnecessary. Did you hear me say that? If both of us are exactly the same, one of us is unnecessary because it's just a carbon copy, a clone of the other person. So let's celebrate each other's differences. We are given different gifts. These are the key things that make room for a happy, joyful, loving family. Number four, is it? The world's principles should not be our principles, but the principles of Christ. We see that in verse 17 to 20. The world has defined all sorts of ways to do things, and that is why our homes are breaking down. Where the man can just decide, you know what, there's nothing wrong with having a mistress. The woman can decide, I can have my own too. It's not going to work. Because how many of us would be in that relationship? Hollywood is not the model for marriages. They do all this drama, they do all the celebrity things, and then at the end of the day, they get divorced. And those people who don't know God, and some of us are trying to sell our marriage after. Brangelina. You know who I'm talking about? Some Hollywood star. They were the most most celebrated couple in Hollywood. And you know the root of their marriage, the foundation of that marriage was faulty. The Bible says if the foundation be faulty, there's nothing the righteous can do. The man was married. He went on first to ask Mr. and Mrs. Smith with Angelina Jolie. You know the story. So I don't need to tell you. She collected him from his wife. And then they lived together for 10 years. Got married after 10 years, and after 2 years of the so-called marriage, divorced. The foundation is faulty. So why would we follow such examples to build our own home? The word of God is good enough an example. Husbands, love your wife. Wives, submit. Even if you don't know anything, if you obey these two, it's enough. How do I mean? It is hard for one man to love only one woman. Hard. You know why? Men are moved by what they see. You think you married Miss Walls. Wait till another one shows up. My driver one day was taking me out somewhere. My former driver. And one lady with, she wore leggings and had big, passed in front of the car. He was driving, he slowed down. I had to call him and say, hey, and you are married with two children. What are you doing? I caught him, so I couldn't deny anything. He just started laughing. I said, hey, you. Men are moved by what they see. So God already knows that this thing called Eve that he created will always catch the attention of men. So there's a propensity, a likelihood that after he has married this one, his eyes will see another one and another one. And listen, if you are lustful, pray against the spirit of love. Because even if you marry Miss Universe, you will still see another one that whose statistics is better than the one you married. Every statistic, you will see another one. So if God understood, that's why I said, husband, love your wife. That one is tough. Because for you to love a woman you don't understand, it's tough. Men, don't bother. Because when, you know, men sometimes get confused. What do we do with this daughter of you? You can never be right. I remember a young man was saying, you can't ever be right with women. Just make sure whatever they say, yes, it's fine. Because if you go this way, they will come from that way. If you go this way, they will come from that angle. As if we are some kind of species. Don't bother. Just love us. You know the reason you shouldn't bother? When God created the woman, he gave you anesthesia. You'll be asleep. So if you don't understand the intricate fabric with which he creates this gender called woman. A woman with a womb. So when Adam woke up, hey! You know, God, the Bible says God forms the man, which means he puts God, you know, the things together. Bicep and guy just dropped. Bicep here, tricep, big back, everything. Everything was just put together, pow, you know? And the guy just, boom. You know that macho thing, you know? The guy just showed up, like, yeah. God, he just woke up from sleep, from his deep anesthesia. And then there was this creature that he had never seen before. When he woke up, he said, wow, whoa, man. That's how he called him. Like, whoa, man. God took extra time to create him. The Bible says the woman was created. Go and read it. So God took time delicately to fabricate and to put the texture of her voice. She is the crescendo of creation. The icing on the cake. The top of it all. So that's the woman. That's the reason why they will always track our head, the men. Thank God, what would we do without this woman? There's nothing we can do. We can't even be here without them. So just take us as we are. Just love us. That's all we need. Love, be kind, be gentle, listen, pay attention. Every woman who wants to enjoy her husband, three things. not a want, it's a need. Every man was created with something called ego. E-G-O. It doesn't matter how nice and gentle the man is, he has ego. It is God that put it there. So the earlier we all recognize it, humble ourselves and respect him. Respect is a need. Number two. Honor. They look similar, but they are different. Honor is different from respect. You respect a person. Honor means what is due him. Let it be given to him. What he belittling must not come near him. Honor. Honor is a need. Is a necessity. Something every man needs. Number three. S-E-X. I'm sure we're all matured in the house. It's not a want. It's a need. Except if you are not married to a male man. But if you are married to a male man, it's a need. But for you to get these three things, men, which are very critical, I told you the ingredients. Pay attention. Be gentle. Be kind. Be nice to your woman. Very simple. God has not complicated life. We made it very simple. We are the one that is trying to complicate it. And the last one I want to say is in verse 32. Be kind one to another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, Christ has given, forgiven us. Even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. Kindness. Kindness. We see that reverberated earlier on in verse 23 and 32-31. No corrupt communication must come from our mouth, but edifying words without power. Don't use unkind or hurtful words. We can't afford to use unkind or hurtful words. I regret marrying you. That's not kind. Let me say this first. Words are like eggs, like we all know. The moment it falls, it's broken, you can't pack it back and put it in the shell. Words that are destructive and painful and that will hurt destroy relationships. That doesn't bring the love. It waters down, it drains the oil of love in any relationship and in any marriage. It doesn't help. So we need to be kind, tender hearted, forgiving. Let me stop here on forgiveness. We would all hurt each other. We would all hurt each other. It doesn't matter how nice you are. I've hurt my husband several times. And he has hurt me several times. You will say things to have. You will do things to have done. But hear me this proposal. You started with gentlemen and women. It takes me to say I'm sorry. And forgive. I'm going to expand a lot on that tomorrow. It takes a lot of humility to admit that I've wronged you and I'm sorry. And if you want to keep love in your home, if you believe that, if we believe that we have been that your brother has all against you, not you, but you remember that somebody has all against you, said leave your gifts and go and reconcile to them. What does that leave us? Both ways, what would be the continuity of reconciliation and forgiveness on us? Every time we refuse to forgive ourselves, we are holding our relationship back. We are holding ourselves back. Nelson Mandela said one time that, see, because if you don't forgive, after a while you get bitter. And bitterness is like drinking poison and expecting somebody else to die. It doesn't work that way. We will all offend each other, and somebody will offend you. Your spouse will offend you. How about we making up our mind that before they offend us, we will forgive us? All of us who are here, we are married to somebody who has offended you. Some of us are still carrying those wounds in our hearts. Unkind words have been spoken to us. Degrading words have been spoken to us. Things have been done to us that should not have been done. The child of God, I want you to tell you, whatever your spouse has done to you, under God, I want to ask you to forgive them. Whatever your child has done to you, I want to ask you to forgive that child. Because they can't go forward if you are holding them in unforgiveness. Your spouse cannot go forward if you are holding them in unforgiveness. Because when you are unforgiving, what is going to do for you? And you're holding yourself back. Why? Because God says, if you don't forgive the person who forgives you or offended you, your father will not forgive you. So it's also affecting you. All heads bowed and every eye closed. I want to pray with you. You are here. Three categories. The first one, your spouse has offended you and is hurting you till now. You are in the presence of God. There's healing found in here. I want you to talk to God. Tell God what the person has done to you. And let God know you are hurting. And right now you have not yet forgiven them, but you need His grace to forgive them. And you need to trust God for that grace to release them. Because when you release them, you release yourself. Second, it's not your spouse. For somebody, even either at work, an in-law, a parent-in-law, a child, a colleague, a friend, a family member has offended you, and you are still holding that grudge in your heart. This is your moment. God wants you to release them. The third person, you are aggrieved against your pastor. Now this is tough. The third category, you are aggrieved against spiritual authority. You must forgive. So your life can advance and move forward because you have held yourself back. You have held back your progress by that offense. Satan has given you that bait of offense. And because your pastor or someone in authority has offended you and you're holding that grudge, you have literally put a barrier to your own progress. You need to release them for your own and forgive. If you are in any of these three categories, wherever you are, don't stand up, don't lift your hand, don't put your hand on your chest. And as you're praying with your hands on your chest, God says, release them. Ask Him right now for the grace to release that person. It may be your spouse. A woman here, your husband has wounded you so bad with his words. In fact, you are contemplating a divorce or separation as we speak. God is asking you to release him. Hand him over to me. Yes, God. And watch what I will do. If it's a family member, in-law, brother-in-law, sister-in-law, cousin, anybody, uncle, God wants you to release it. There's a guy here, you live with your auntie and they wounded you so badly. Some auntie, some older person that did you so much wrong and you held that for years. God says release them. Release that woman. Release that woman. Because you are just one step. You are one step to a breakthrough. But because of that, you have held yourself back. Release them to this moment. bring. Grant each man grace in the name of Jesus. Let there be grace to forgive, grace to release, grace to let go. In the name of Jesus, we break the hold of unforgiveness. We break the hold of offense. We break the hold of resentment. We break the hold of bitterness. In the name of Jesus, Father, let the healing power of God flow into our hearts. The balm of Gilead, I call upon you in the name of Jesus. Jesus, you are the balm of Gilead. Move into our hearts. Let there be healing in the soul. Let there be healing in the spirit. Let there be healing in the recesses of our hearts and the archives of our history. In the name of Jesus. Enter into our homes and bring peace. Enter into our hearts and bring peace. In the name of Jesus. Help this woman to forgive her husband. Help the man to forgive his wife. Help this man or woman to forgive those who have offended. Thank you.